Friends, the midnight hour is at hand, and tomorrow will soon become today. What is gone is done.
The man is Harry Granite, and the first time those words were spoken was on March 25th, 1922. On that day, KGW Radio was born, and in that decade, America came of age. Babe Ruth was king, and the fans swarmed to the World Series to see the Babe record history and home runs. Baseball was the national pastime and the national frenzy. From the major leagues to the minor leagues, baseball fans were building heroes, and the heroes were becoming legends. The local fans were part of that national spirit as they cheered the Portland Beavers through downtown into Vaughn Street Ballpark, where the jam-packed house waited for the opening baseball game. Dancing girls, bands, and an opening speech by Mayor Baker brought the local festivities to a climax. Then it was up to the Beavers to make their bid for recognition. KGW covered the event by telephone, and the first of a long series of sports reports began. Red Grange, the galloping ghost, was to help usher football and himself into the Hall of Fame. Open field running and plays that dazzled the audience were part of the new era in sports. America was coming alive, and radio, that newfangled invention, was alive with it. That long count in the Dempsey-Tunney match was to go down in the record books as the fight of the century. But sports and radio weren't the only showstoppers of the 20s. The Red Hot Mamas and the Charleston were shaking the nation from its dance halls to its dives, to its new crystal sets. And then there was George Gershwin and Rhapsody in Blue, and beautiful music made another debut. Music, dance, sports became the heart of the 20s, until technology started flapping its fantasies and wings.
Those magnificent men in their flying machine, they go up to the up, up, they go down to the up, down. They charge all the ladies and steal all the scene, with their up to the up, up, and their down to the up, down.
The air, once free for the birds and imagination, was now finding its space being invaded by the newcomers, airplanes and airwaves. And the airwaves of Portland were alive with the city's first radio station, KGW. The historic broadcast was to feature Mary Garden, but the fame star was too tired to get out of bed. So Chicago's lyric soprano, Edith Mason, stepped in. The music was from the opera Madame Butterfly, the aria, Un Bel Di, One Fine Day. And with the music came the Hoot Owls, and the first variety show in the nation began.
This is Harry Granite, the grand string bean of the Hoot Owls. A lot of people still remember the show, although it ran 30, 40 years ago. People used to say to me, oh, I used to listen to your program. I listened to your program every Friday night. Now they say my mother used to listen to your program every Friday night when she was a little girl.
The KGW Hoot Owls, known as the Keep Growing Wiser Order, began their broadcasts from the Oregonian Tower in downtown Portland. Owned and operated by the Oregonian, KGW promised good speakers, music, and news. And news it was when the KGW sound car broadcast the bulletins of Lindbergh's incredible solo flight from New York to Paris. The spirit of St. Louis and Lucky Lindy were vaulted into the limelight as the 1920s created another national hero. Ticker tape parades in New York gave way to parades in Portland as Oregonians celebrated the Lone Eagle's historic flight. KGW covered the event as Mayor Baker greeted Charles Lindbergh at Swan Island. But before the celebrations had ended, the bright and beautiful decade that paraded its heroes and conquered the dreams of flight and sound collapsed. And with it, a nation that soft-chewed and smiled its way into depression. The once buoyant and ragtime nation was sinking to its knees. Men searched for work where there wasn't any. It was a time for bread lines, and unemployment signs hung on every fence and doorpost. A nation that had screamed for the Babe Ruths and Red Granges now sat dazed and quiet with no one. The country that had fought to end all wars was now at battle in a new kind of war, with a new enemy, fear and hunger. And then the quiet broke loose, and the veterans demanded the reserve money the government had promised. Congress voted no, and the angered mobs broke into a riot in front of the Capitol. The jubilant 20s had turned to the panic of the 30s as the nation reeled in the wave of terror and hopelessness. Burning and wrecking became an answer, but only for a moment. Then time took over. And after time, a quiet, almost complete sense of pain. The pain men wrote on their faces with the words, nowhere, what now? From New York to Denver to Portland, nothing. Nothing but days that yield only more days, and hopes that yield only fewer hopes. Food was the first problem that had to be solved, and the Willamette Valley and KGW were to prove there was a solution. The rollicking hoot owls that had entertained thousands of Portlanders turned their talents to another direction, feeding the hungry. KGW initiated the hoot owl cannery, and hundreds of unemployed went back to work. The fields were harvested, and the hungry were fed. In conjunction with the Sunshine Division, KGW delivered truckloads of food to the needy. The first radio station in Portland had turned into a voice for the people. And the power of radio as an arm of the public was felt throughout the city. Entertainment and free radios for shut-ins brought KGW additional praise. But the tide of the Depression was about to turn. And the man responsible for that turn was Franklin Delano Roosevelt. FDR and the New Deal swept the country, and the good times were getting closer. KGW merged with KEX as the blue and red networks of NBC. And soon after, the local news staff became the training ground for the greats, such as Chet Huntley.
It was at KGW where I first got the genuine and determined conviction that there was a future in broadcast journalism. And that being so, I wanted a piece of it. I wanted to participate in it.
From the news department to the entertainment stars, and KGW was at it again with Mel Blanc.
Me. What's up, Doc?
For my second number on this program. Oh, boy. And then I wrote...
Ooh, I thought I saw a putty cat. I did see a putty cat.
You betty swap, putty cat. That putty cat is me, suffering fuckatash.
Of course, Barney Rubble on the Flintstones.
I just did that to let you know who the heck I am.
Mel Blanc, the grand snicker of the Hoot Owls, created his own voices on KGW's Cobwebs and Nuts. The times were packed with locally written and produced shows like Covered Wagon Days and Homicide Squad, a forerunner to TV's Dragnet. Names like Jennings, White, Halleck, Morrison, Van Fleming were heard along with the KGW Orchestra. News kept pace as Phil Irwin and Chet Huntley covered the crime of the decade, the Lindbergh trial. Flemington, New Jersey was the scene of the trial. The crime, the murder of Lindbergh's son, Charles Augustus Lindbergh, Jr. He'd been kidnapped, and his life held for $50,000 in ransom. The money was paid, but the boy was found dead. All that remained were some tattered clothes and a memory. The Lone Eagle, America's hero of the 20s, became the tragic figure of the 30s. The killer, Bruno Hauptmann, was found while passing part of the ransom money. The largest manhunt of the century had ended, and the trial began. Bruno was found guilty and condemned to death. No ticker tape parade greeted the day. The crowds waited, not for Lindbergh, but a child's killer.
The National Broadcasting Company presents a special bulletin from the Press Radio News, Trenton, New Jersey. Bruno Richard Hauptmann was electrocuted at 8:47 tonight for the murder of the Lindbergh baby.
But the 30s weren't about to stand still for anybody or anything. Benny Goodman's Jitterbug became the craze, and news in the Depression seemed like a bad dream. America had had gone wild again, and the blindness that comes with joy had overtaken the country. No one was listening to the distant rumbles from Europe. No one wanted to know that death was stalking them again. Not now. Not when it seemed they had licked the world. They had beat the Depression and fought the war to end all wars.
In the past, wir in Betrügen, die euch jahrhundertlang ausgedankt haben, lasst euch nicht nichtslos in den Schoßigen dumm genug sind, sich uns zu widersetzen, werden wir nicht vergessen. Aber wir werden auch die nicht vergessen, die den richtigen Weg einschlagen.
Madmen were marching, and the soldiers and people were following. Cheers and jackboots echoed through the streets, and still, America waited. Waited for Europe to lick her own wounds. Waited for Europe to be quiet. Waited for Europe to go away. Waited. What was there to fear? Hadn't the country united under FDR? This was no time to worry about foreign wars on foreign soil. A new age was being born with the sounds and styles of laughter and celebration.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, by air, President Roosevelt has just announced. The attack also was made on all naval and military activities on the principal island of Oahu.
I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
Now it was Germany and Adolf Hitler that came to fight. Within a week, the United States had declared war on Japan and Germany. Hitler and Mussolini were no longer distant rumbles from another shore. It was American blood now, and the rumbles pounded and echoed through every street and city in the nation. The enemy was attacking as countries fell in the humility of defeat. Adolf Hitler's war machine mercilessly drove millions from their homes to death, the concentration camps, the oven. Peacetime industries were converted to war industries as armament and ships poured off the assembly lines. Portland became a shipbuilding town, and with the nation behind the war effort, shipbuilding boomed. Materials covered the docks as men worked around the clock to equip ships for the American Navy. With ships came men, and with men came guns and planes. A whole nation had come to war. They came as carpenters, builders, scholars, and cab drivers. They came to fight with their own tools. They came so all could come home in peace. KGW launched their own initiative with war bond drives and programs supporting our men in uniform. The momentum was growing, and on June 6, 1944, KGW announced the Allied thrust.
People of Western Europe, a landing was made this morning on the coast of France by troops of the Allied Expeditionary Force. This landing is part of the concerted United Nations plan for the liberation of Europe.
From the turning point of the war in Germany to the turning point of the war in Japan.
We shall go forward, trusting in thee, knowing that we are in thy care now and forever. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
The Allied troops had landed in Normandy, and the United States had dropped the A-bomb on Hiroshima. The wars were soon over. And radio, pressed into war service too, now returned home. KGW continued to report news with men like Coffin, Foster, Tomlinson, Swofford, Norton, and Hemingway. The station grew, and with it the personnel. A live orchestra, chorus, and education, religious, and farm directors joined the already talented staff. Radio was at its height, and the public loved it. Local shows were backed up by national shows, and the sounds and stars became household words.
And now the Jell-O family presents...
Henry! Henry Aldrich!
Come in, Mother.
And welcome to Mr. W.C. Fields. He's sent you been a hiccup.
All right, Charlie.
How could you possibly have thought that I wouldn't last? After all, a man my age is just in the prime of life.
I guess you're right, Jack. They've been priming you for 20 years.
From Hollywood, the Jimmy Durante Show.
Eight.
commercials became as well known as the shows. In fact, it was KGW that produced the first singing commercial in the nation for Sears and Roebuck back in the 1920s.
Pepsi Cola hits the spot. 12 full ounces, that's a lot. Twice as much for a nickel, too. Pepsi Cola is the drink for you.
Rinse all white and rinse all bright.
L-A-V-A, L-A-V-A.
But KGW wasn't merely a funnel for national commercials and shows. It was an originator. And one of the most well-known shows was Remember Our Men. Conceived by Arden Pangborn, the variety show was dedicated to the veterans. The idea became so successful that hundreds of national stars participated throughout the United States.
From the stage of J.J. Parker's Broadway Theater, KGW presents Remember Our Men.
In recognition of the fact that although peace has come, the war may never be over for many of our servicemen and women, I pledge that I shall continue to entertain hospitalized veterans whenever and wherever I can.
But the war and the 40s hadn't stopped taking their toll yet, as Portland became gripped in one of the worst floods of the century, Vanport. The KGW tower toppled as an entire city was engulfed by the Columbia. On an emergency transmitter, KGW covered the tragedy.
Damaged the building to such extent that they were just shredded, and some of the roofs torn off and the walls caved in tremendously. And a majority of the lower stories were completely covered. You just see the tips of the roof, and the upper stories were half covered with water. And, well, there wasn't much chance for survival of those that were in the lower stories that we could see. But we made a very thorough search of all those upper story apartments and broke windows and went in and investigated as best we could. But, well, nothing much else you can do except look.
And before the waves of the turbulent 40s had time to recede, America launched into a new decade and a new war, Korea. The police action was to end in indecision and compromise, but the United States had started down a new road, a road of long, costly, and continuous battles for goals we could never define.
I am an American, a Negro, a student attending college in Nashville, Tennessee. Just 3 months ago, it was impossible for me to use the dining facilities in the dime stores and the department stores in the city of Nashville. But today, this is possible because hundreds of students, armed with only a dream, fought one of the greatest battles this country has ever known.
At home, the country was beginning to realize that Lincoln's abolition of slavery was a reality. A reality that 100 years of repression wasn't about to hide. From Peoria to Portland, from San Francisco to Selma, blacks were sitting down and standing in for their rights as human beings and as Americans. KGW was responsive to the clash of events, and under the new ownership of Mrs. Dorothy Bullitt, the station continued to press for accurate news coverage. But blacks weren't the only ones being purged. Senator Joseph McCarthy from Wisconsin was to see to that, and KGW radio was to play it for the public.
Well, last night I discussed the communists in the State Department. I stated that I had the names of 57 card-carrying members of the Communist Party. I noticed today that the State Department has denied that. They say they don't know of a single one in the State Department. Now, I want to tell the Secretary of State this. If he wants to call me tonight at the Utah Hotel, I'll be glad to give him the names of those 57 card-carrying communists. Now, I don't claim to be any FBI or anything, so that when I have the names of 57, you can be right well sure there are a lot more.
But the junior senator was a liar. There weren't 57 card-carrying communists in the State Department. There were none. But the Red Scare and the big lie technique had started, and thousands were to be ruined by rumor and innuendo before McCarthy had finished. But the Senate investigating committees weren't about to put away their hatchets, as KGW, Portland, and Mayor Shrunk were to find out. The Senate Rackets Committee had accused Shrunk of taking a gambling bribe from Big Jim Elkins. Bobby Kennedy led the vicious attack.
At the time of the detector test, I asked that it be given by the Federal Bureau of Investigation or by a recognized national expert.
KGW broadcast portions of the hearings and Shrunk's later trial. Both the probe and the trial found him innocent. While KGW News covered the events, the Big W played the hit sounds.
Music
was making its radio bid for recognition, and the audience responded by demanding more. The sound of the 50s gave way to the 60s. The 1960s brought KGW to new quarters, this time with the addition of KGW-TV and Kink FM. But the radio sounds and the newness of the 60s couldn't hide the tragedies as America began ripping her own guts out. Before the decade was to end, John Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, and Martin Luther King were dead by assassin bullets. With regret for history, KGW broadcast those events.
And the glow from that fire can truly light the world. And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
Well, we are making some moves already in opening additional facilities, rather, that have not been open, particularly in the Deep South, such as hotels and theaters. We have already started some work in these areas, having stand-ins at theaters and negotiating to get hotels to open their facilities, and if not, using direct action.
Senator Kennedy has been shot. Is that possible?
No.
Is that possible?
It's been
shot. Is it possible, ladies and gentlemen? It is possible. He has. Not only Senator Kennedy. Oh my God. Senator Kennedy has been shot. And another man, a Kennedy campaign manager, and possibly shot in the head.
Between the deaths and the funerals came the riots and the dream.
I have a dream today. When we allow freedom ring from every village and every hamlet, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
But the violence wasn't over as the nation's youth took to the streets to demand the immediate withdrawal of all United States military personnel from Vietnam. It was another decade, another generation, but we were still at war. Hubert Humphrey, then vice president, visited Portland, and the usually quiet city turned into a battleground. KGW followed the event, reporting on the spot news. But the nation was in chaos, morally and physically, as the blacks, the young, the minorities, and even the middle class exploded with hates and fears. The country demanded a change in leadership, and Richard Nixon was elected to make that change. But change is not always easy to come by. The swamps of Vietnam are still filled with American soldiers. The young, once the only loud voice against the war, are now joined by the middle-aged, whose pocketbook and spirit have been exhausted. Death becomes commonplace and impartial. The soldier, the child, the yellow, the white, all go.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius.
Some say airplanes and airwaves have come a distance since 1922. Some wonder. And some ignore the nation's fears and explore their own needs as smack, pot, speed crowd their way onto the scene.
They paid paradise, put up a parking lot.
But the blindness of drugs and war are being challenged by a greater need, the need to preserve the earth. From massive highways to air pollution, and from massive industrialization to land and river pollution, the nation is sinking into its man-made abyss. And still, we celebrate. A nation that has been rocked with tragedy, war, depression, and hunger still celebrates its aliveness. As long as there is joy, music, singing, and laughter, as long as people can participate through whatever form they choose, from radio to rock festivals to records, there's a chance that we will continue to be alive, to make changes, to live and enjoy our world. KGW is as much a part of these changes now as we were in 1922. The voices and sounds have changed. The message hasn't.
62 KGW.
Donnie Albert of KGW with Don Wright at 22 minutes before 10. And honey, I can't help myself. In fact, heck, I don't want to help myself.
KGW.
Here's the third of four in a row on KGW with Fell Arbor. What a track record this one has. Giant song in the Northwest and all over the country today. This is Heart of Gold by Neil Young.
KGW.
Precious and few though they may be, nothing like a climactic note to move us in the right direction towards the weekend. 2:32 at KGW. This is Mike Rivers on a Friday afternoon.
At 7:33, this is Bob Scott on 62 KGW with a little Three Dog Night from Harmony. 11:23 with Joe Cooper in the nighttime, getting on that horse with no name. Here's America.
More music. KGW.
3:25 in the morning. This is Dan Martin at the Big 62 with the third of seven hits in a row.
This is Ed Viley moving the music on a Saturday night from the Big 62 with the Detroit Emeralds.
56 degrees and clear. Jeffrey Hendricks, KGW News. Multnomah County Circuit Court Judge William Dale has granted the state of Oregon a temporary restraining order
to mediate in Portland. He also appointed Kenneth Brown to mediate in a separate dispute between the board and district employees other than teachers. Joel Martin reporting for KGW News.
62 KGW.
The sounds are 1972. The event about to become history is KGW's 50th anniversary. Today salutes yesterday. And tomorrow, today.
Friends, midnight hour is at hand, and tomorrow will soon become today. What is gone is done. Each song or laugh or jest far-flung is on its way to join the ages of the past. Here we stand, the center of a mighty web of golden rays, radiant beams which travels a flock to countless thousands. To happy homes and cheerful firesides, but as well to some less fortunately blessed by kindly fate. Should anyone ask us why the hoot owls, this our answer, to spread a little sunshine. And this our earnest prayer, that to those who laugh we may send our mirth to mingle, but to those deprived of sunshine and the joy of living, we each laugh or song or jest we send our blessing and our hope. But to some pale lips we may have brought a smile and to others a moment's rest from pain. And as this day is ending and another being born, by the ancient symbol of the chimes we voice our hope that tomorrow may be happier than today for friends whose portion has been most hard to bear. Today is yesterday, and tomorrow is today.